Good evening. I'm Lou Goldstein, and welcome to another edition of Health Watch. Tonight we'll be talking about COVID-19, the coronavirus, and we have a lot to talk about. I have two guests with me today. I have Sabrina Sabatier, who's the Director of Recovery Support for Prevention Links, and I also have Sean Foley, who's the Assistant Director of Community Prevention for Prevention Links, and we'll be talking a lot about what Prevention Links does, and also how you can help cope with any anxiety that you may have from being inside and being self-centered, self-isolated, really about having to take the proper precautions. One of the most important parts of this is that, as we all know, we're in the same boat together. Basically, we're in a war on this virus, and the more information you have, the better you'll feel about being able to go about your day-to-day routines in the new normal. So hopefully our conversation today will help you and will serve as a starting point for you to reflect upon the resources that are available to you and the fact that we all are in this together and we're not isolating ourselves from this. So first of all, I'd like to welcome you, Sabrina and Sean. Thank you for joining us today. We have a lot to talk about, but the first thing I want to talk with you about is, as I indicated before, a lot of people have a lot of anxiety, mm-hmm. At this time, and some are having a tougher time than others. Mm-hmm. And so maybe you could talk a little bit about that, about how people can deal with the anxiety mm-hmm. that they're feeling at the current time.
Okay. So thank you for inviting us, and I really appreciate the opportunity to talk to the community and residents about how best to deal with this crisis in what I call very abnormal times. This has never happened in our history, unless you count the flu pandemic of 1918, but this is more unique in terms of how we are isolating ourselves. The first thing I want to mention is that these are times that are scary, and they are a time where it is okay to worry. It's our worrying that helps keep us safe. Fear and anxiety, sometimes it's designed to keep us protected. And it's what keeps you away from a dark alleyway at 3 a.m. and gets you to safety. What I worry about, though, is that many of us will be feeling so much anxiety that it will hurt our ability to function at home, function to work from home, function with our family, and cause us great distress. So the first thing I want to say is it's okay to feel a little anxious here. It is anxious times, and we're not sure of how to go forward. And we don't know what to expect. We don't know how long this is going to be. And so there is going to be a bit of anxiety to that. And that's normal. And so it's okay to feel that way. I know often people who have anxiety feel guilty about feeling the anxiety. They feel guilty in front of being anxious in front of their kids, in front of their loved ones, or any other family members. And that's okay. Part of it, what we have to understand, is we also want to make sure that we are being psychologically active with each other. And what I mean by that is we are engaging in conversation face-to-face. We are trying our best to keep in contact through the technological innovations we have, through family and friends, and staying connected, although we are separated. One thing we need to do in spite of this is that we want to make sure that we are not constantly checking about the virus. And what I mean by that is we want to make sure we have up-to-date information. But what I'm worried about is people who are more anxious are constantly checking for the bad news. And so because we have a constant flow of information coming through at all times, we're going to hear the worst stories. And so we want to be able to make sure that when we are feeling our most anxious, to be able to put the phone down and put the iPad down or shut the TV off, because that will increase one's anxiety. So limiting the amount of, I wouldn't say, I'm not limiting the amount of information, but if you're feeling anxious, realizing it and trying to put down the phone for a little bit and try to engage with a loved one at the home. If you are isolated at home by yourself, we're talking about a whole other different issue. Using technological means to find some way to connect. There are organizations and communities that are looking to find connection through people who may be isolated. So that is something we need to talk about further. But for now, I think, is to really focus on what you have, and what not just the bad that's going on, but also some of the good. You know, and that can be difficult in times like these, but it is a necessity because these are strange and difficult times.
Well, they are unusual times, and just picking up on what you said, a lot of people, you're right, are looking at TV and they're hearing, you know, bad news and making them more anxious. And a lot of times it's easier just to, you know, look at your phone, mm-hmm. you know, constantly, or maybe too constantly, right? Whether it's the financial markets or the health news or the news coming out from various health sources, to feel that you need to keep connected. But sometimes you need to be disconnected.
Correct.
From that. And sometimes you need to, you know, basically find other things around the house to do.
Exactly. And to real quick, what anxiety does is anxiety, when we're seeing irrational amounts of anxiety, and a lot of this is brand new, so we're going to feel, if we feel a tickle in our throat, we're going to get really anxious, right? Or if we feel a sort of symptom, we're going to start checking on it. Anxiety consists, kind of always tells us to continuously check. But when we check or when we try to reason with the anxiety, we tend to feel more anxious because either we try to find some good news, whatever the case may be, when we're consistently checking to validate our concerns, it ends up getting us more anxious. So anxiety is a very, especially at this time, can be irrational and unreasonable. And the idea is if you're home, being safe, protecting yourselves and the family, social distancing, you're doing the right job. And the issue we're having today with this social distancing is the people who aren't really anxious about it. Right. So, having anxiety, having a little bit of concern is good because you're putting your family and yourself at safety. But when we feel so irrational, when we feel so anxious that we keep checking on things, symptoms, things are going on in the news, as a way to hopefully calm the anxiety, it does the opposite. We tend to get more anxious. And so we want to be careful of that too.
Okay. Are there any measures besides shutting off the TV and maybe taking a walk in the neighborhood, any advice that you could give for individuals?
Yeah, so I definitely think it's very important to stay connected. So I know during this time we are practicing social distancing, but the technology makes it easily available that we can still stay connected with one another, whether that's, you know, sending a text message to check in with your neighbors or your friends, FaceTime calls. I know we do a lot of Zoom meetings, different ways to see other people, right? I also, as you said, I think it's really important to get outside, breathe fresh air, go for a walk, exercise, try to establish a routine. I know right now things are so up in the air and they change day by day, but as much routine that you can establish, all of that kind of creates a new sense of normalcy.
Right. And I think especially for a lot of businesses too, that are closed, it wouldn't hurt to try and frequent those businesses, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Put in a call, because we all like to support our local businesses and do it in a safe way, since we can't eat in restaurants, but maybe do curbside or delivery or just find ways to support yourself so that you're feeling like it's normal. It's a normal day, that if you can do it, do it. But I'm sure there's a lot of individuals who are struggling right now and I'm sure need your services. And maybe you can talk a little bit about what Prevention Links is and what your challenges are in this unusual world that we face today.
Sure. So Prevention Links is a nonprofit organization located in Union County. We do have sites throughout the state, not only in Union County, but we have three different divisions. So one of them is a Family Success Division, which is their primary focus is to prevent child abuse and neglect. And essentially they are like community centers where families can come, participate in different family friendly activities and workshops. Again, a lot of face-to-face contact. We also have a prevention division, which does a lot of programming in schools, teaching youth different prevention techniques and strategies to prevent, again, substance use disorder. And then we also have a recovery support division, which has a variety of different peer-based recovery supports. So this includes Recovery High School, which is a partnership with Prevention Links and Union County VOTEC. We have a family support program. We have a program called Union County STAR, which is peers and non-clinical case management, providing direct services to individuals and linkage to different treatment programs. It is important to note that all of our services are non-clinical, but we often can refer people or link them to different clinical services or different, you know, whether that's housing services or food pantries if that's in need, different community resources, depending on that need. So a lot of our work is direct interaction with individuals. So we have been impacted in that work is more challenging in this time, right? With the recommendations of social distancing, with individuals being, and rightfully so, more cautious in staying home. We definitely saw, you know, declines in attendance of programs. But I think that the agency has done a fantastic job in getting creative and trying to, you know, change how we serve the community, right? So we're still keeping to our mission. The community is still extremely important to us. Just how we get this information to them, how we serve them, looks a little different now. So I could speak to the recovery support division, specifically sort of the STAR program that I spoke of, right? Where individuals meet face to face, there's a peer, there's a non-clinical case management. A lot of that work right now is a lot of phone follow-up. And I've seen our participants are so grateful to get that call from somebody that they know, that they have rapport with, that they have a relationship with, right? And that they're just checking in with them, seeing how they're doing, especially if you're home and isolated, whether it's alone, right, or with your family, mm-hmm. you're seeing the same people, you're talking to the same people every day. So it's nice to get a call from somebody else. And it also brings that sense of normalcy as well. Like, hey, you know, we're not meeting face-to-face, and yet things may look a little different, but we're still here for you. Union County Helping Hands 365 has a hotline that's available 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, where individuals can call and receive peer support, peer recovery support, as well as, you know, linkages to different resources. The phone number is 1-855-825-3275. So we also host a family support group, as well as a number of different mutual aid groups. And we've moved to an online platform for that right now. So individuals can access it remotely and still see each other and see the staff that they're familiar with and the other people that attend the group as well. So that's been a one way that we've kind of gotten creative and trying to meet the needs.
Okay. Sean, you want to add anything?
So yeah, our organization is being really, really progressive in the way we're communicating with members, with the community, with participants. And we, as a community organization, believe that it's vital that we enhance community even in this time of social distancing. You mentioned before about the support of local businesses, and that's so vital. And I think during this pandemic, what is really important, and I think I kind of call this for everybody, mental health providers, other human service organizations, who I'm sure are doing the work, but it's really important that we do things and we really take a step into our community in assisting those. We don't know how long this is going to last. We hope it's a very short duration. But we're seeing what's happening in California.
Right.
We're seeing what happened in Italy. And we may be embracing the same thing shortly. And so we have to realize that as much as we have to have necessities, food, water, shelter, all of these things for our citizens, but we also want to make sure that they're having that necessity of human connection. And so we may have to get uncomfortable. We may have to reach out for people we don't know. We're going to have to use the means of electronic communication that we use, but we have to make sure that we are checking in our backyard. And this is going to be a community response. And we have to ensure the safety of our most vulnerable and our families and households and our community at large. And we want to make sure that we're checking in. You know, tough times breed, you know, really good actions. And I think I've seen it across the board in Cranford and other parts of Union County, these really positive actions. We just want to make sure we're maintaining that because humans need social connection. We thrive, we need it. You know, we say we need food, water, air, but we need each other too. And this is a tough time for people. You know, before I got here, I saw a friend, we were I was 10, 12 feet away from his car screaming at each other. It's kind of funny, but it's sad. You know, that's how we're going to live for a little bit, you know? And so we want to make sure that we are distancing, but we're also staying connected. And we're fortunate enough to have the tools to connect.
Right. That's true. And a lot of people are working remotely from home right mm-hmm. now and finding out how tough it is to balance work life and family life. And living on top of one another mm-hmm. and getting to know each other too, which they may not have gotten known for a long time, because when you go to work in the morning, you come home, you know, in the evening, and you have this short period of time, and now you're around each other all day. So the CDC has, you know, made the recommendations, and you'll notice that we're not at the TV 35 studios. We're in a remote site right now, and we are taking the necessary precautions of staying about 6 to 7 feet away from each other during this interview. So you may already know the CDC recommendations, but it bears repeating about washing your hands often for at least 20 seconds or saying happy birthday twice, covering your cough or sneeze with a tissue and then throwing the tissue in the trash, to make sure that you clean and disinfect frequently any touched objects in your house, whether they're handles, whether they're surface areas, make sure that they're cleaned. And above all, stay home when you're sick. If you feel that you have the fever or cough, then check in with your local doctor, and that doctor will make the recommendation as to whether or not you should be tested. You should contact the health worker if you have symptoms, and try not to touch your face and eyes. Don't travel unnecessarily if you have a fever or cough. And just, you know, do the smart thing, because the virus does not distinguish between those of us who are young or old. It's not just a 60 plus. It affects those, it has shown to be effective in affecting people in their teens and 20s and 30s and 40s and 50s. So it's under 60 and over 60. So everybody's involved in this. And the more that we can self-isolate ourselves for a little time and let this pass and let the health official deal with it, the better off we will be. I also want to thank all the municipal officials who are working day and night on this, as well as all the health officials, both local, statewide, and nationally, who are working to try to make this as safe as possible. But getting back to what we were just talking about, we have a little more questions that we want to talk about. We've talked a little bit about the anxiety issue, mm-hmm. and we've talked a little bit about social distancing. Mm-hmm. So, what steps can be taken by those, by individuals, to avoid temptations eventually during this time?
Yeah. So, I think addiction itself is it's isolating. It's extremely isolating, and such a huge part of recovery is connecting. Is building relationships. It's so much based on relationships. So one key thing I think is to continue those relationships, right? So reaching out to your network, using technology when it's available. There are so many recovery support meetings available online or that are in the process of moving to an online platform, or even phone helplines. All of those resources, I think, are very important and need to be utilized by people in recovery, especially at this time, so in order to avoid those temptations. But it's important to acknowledge that, you know, the temptation, especially in early recovery, it's always going to be there. So trying to stick to your routine, whether that's, you know, attending meetings or practicing mindfulness, exercise, yoga, you know, getting up at a certain time and just maintaining that routine as much as you can in these times is going to be really important, and using each other, right? So reaching out to your network, to people that support you. And it's okay to say, hey, I'm struggling, because I think, you know, as Sean said earlier, we are all feeling a certain amount of anxiety right now.
Sure.
So we are all in this together. And especially for people in recovery, there's such a strong sense of community that, you know, reaching out and saying, I'm struggling and this is what's going on, is going to be really important.
Okay. So we were talking a little bit about resources.
Yeah.
So maybe we could talk a little bit about resources. You know, what resources are out there for people to help them to deal with the various, you know, psychological issues and other issues that may be affecting them on a daily basis.
So Union County has a lot of mental health services. The agency's doors may be closed, but they are still using teletherapy. So I think it's important to reach out and, you know, I'll provide you all with a list of resources if need be, if you can put it on a website or on your Facebook page. Okay. If you follow Prevention Links' Facebook page, we will have a list of resources for everybody also. So follow our page and we'll give information, but that will have a long list of resources in their area.
Okay.
So I think part of that is to find those resources. You can also look, I think there's unionresource.net has a lot of more resources. So the resources are in your backyard, and many of them are still working, but they are working electronically, or they can do it via phone.
Right.
We also want to make sure that we're using other activities. If you have a phone, there are some great apps to keep you calm. Headspace is a great, great application for those who may feel a lot of anxiety. It's a great way to breathing exercise can kind of control that kind of reduce the amount of anxiety one is feeling, and helps practice a reduction in anxious feelings. So we would highly recommend using that app right now. And I believe services became free for everybody during this crisis. I think that, and I think also, you know, using the resource.net, our Facebook page, and any other information to help get the psychological help you may need during this tough time. And it's important that we all have someone to talk to, because we all are feeling lost and we're not sure really where to go. And the supports are there. We really want people to get those supports.
Okay. I know a lot of people are turning to online meetings or chats. And maybe, Sabrina, you can talk a little bit about that, or online meetings, something new, or, you know, how can they be utilized?
Yeah, so online meetings have been around for a while. They're not new. However, I think at the current time, they're more important than ever in terms of practicing social distancing and being able to still access those supports while also maintaining your own well-being and health. So the nice thing about online meetings as well is that there's one available any time, any day. They're accessible regardless of you spoke before about people avoiding temptation. So if you're feeling triggered or anxious or struggling, you can access an online meeting. They're also available through phone support as well. So sometimes it's calling into a meeting, but then also there's programs that offer individual peer support as well, and hotlines that you can call to speak to somebody if you're struggling.
Right. So we talked a little bit about you know, the various resources, and basically, what are, you know, let's just go back for a second and just talk some more about activities or practices that you would recommend at this critical time right now.
I think some of the activities and practices that are best utilized is, as I mentioned before, the Headspace app. Some sort of 10 to 20 minutes a day of just having the ability to just let go. No screens, don't stare at the news at your phone, the news on your TV. It's gonna make you feel more anxious. So it's important to just, if you can, get 10 to 20 minutes to kind of let go. Engage in face-to-face interactions as best as you can, whoever's at your household. If it's just yourself, make sure you're reaching out to people, whether it's a network, community network, or a friend, or a family member. Continue communication and engage with one another as best as you can. I also think, in terms of these anxious times, make sure we don't get caught up in the fear of the pandemic. It is a scary thing, and I'm not saying you're not going to feel afraid, but we also want to look at some of the things that are around us, right? Anxiety takes us away from our present, and it always tells us what if, what if, what if, what if, and we don't know where we're going to be in a week. We don't know where we're going to be in a month, let alone 6 months. But if you are home and you have the things, you have your family, you have all these things right now, you have everything you need. And so part of what we need to do as Americans, as community members, is really focus on what's in front of us. And anxiety is an irrational fear of the future. We can't predict the future, humans can't. So we have to really focus on the now. And that's what will keep us safe and will keep you more psychologically balanced and better able to fight this pandemic.
Okay. So let's talk a little bit more about some ways that individuals who are in recovery, you know, can use their time, especially when, you know, social distancing recommendations are in place currently. I know that a lot of the work that you do involves, you know, groups as well as individual, you know, counseling. And sometimes people feel, you know, adrift when they don't have, you know, Tuesdays at 6 or whatever it is, I'm coming to a place and talking with other people. They don't have that connection. So what can individuals do so they feel that they are not adrift, you know, just floating out there by themselves? Because let's face it, we all are, to a self degree right now, feeling isolated. Mm-hmm. But what can we do as a community to make sure that everyone feels connected as much as possible?
So I think that there's two parts to that. Number one, I think that communities, agencies, organizations that provide those meetings at structured times can do their part to also ensure that it's available and accessible. Still at the time, and I think technology is a great tool that enables us to do that.
Right.
So I know for our agency here at Prevention Links and in the Recovery Support Division, a lot of our meetings that are held at specific times, we are still holding them at those same times.
Right.
It's just a different format, and we get to still see each other. Sometimes somebody's, you know, dog will pop into the camera, and it's just a little bit different, but we're still getting that sense of connectedness. We're still seeing each other, checking in. So individuals can do their part by, again, maintaining their routine as much as possible. So if there's a meeting that you attend at 6 o'clock, seeing is it available online. Things are changing very quickly and have changed.
Right.
And then organizations can do their part also by ensuring that these services that they provide are still accessible through using technology and getting creative, right? So in addition to hosting, you know, different meetings, we're also following up with people more. So letting them know, like, hey, you know, we're not going to have our meeting this week in person the way we normally do, but it's going to be online, and this is how you can access it, and making sure that, you know, they have the information and the tools to be able to access that. Sending newsletters, emails, like just keeping people informed, because things have changed very quickly in the last even week.
You know, we talked about anxiety, but we also need to address stress, because,
yeah,
you know, a lot of times schools are closed, you know, students and children are home now with their parents, you know, businesses are closed except for a couple businesses, you know, like supermarkets, you know, or certain restaurants that are doing curbside or deliveries right now, or doctor's offices, or liquor stores, right? But and certain businesses need to know that we're there. That's why I mentioned businesses. It wouldn't hurt to go and get a gift card from somebody. So I think one of the things that is important is to keep in mind that people feel very stressed because they're working from home, they're working around, you know, their kids. They want to make sure their kids don't get, you know, don't pick up on the vibe that the parents are feeling. And it, for lack of a better word, you cannot go really to the parks right now either, so that avenue is, so I think one of the important things is a lot of times there are people who are very anxious, it doesn't take much, and so this pandemic certainly doesn't help that anxiety, right?
Mm-hmm.
There's also people who are very stressed in life, they have a lot of things going on, and this just seems to be aggravating it. So how can we, what advice can we give to those who feel, to alleviate their stress a little bit, as well as we talked a little bit about their anxiety. So, you know, stress and anxiety sometimes go hand in hand, sometimes
mm-hmm.
they're separate. But what can we say today about those who feel very stressed because of everything?
So stress is really, anxiety is an emotion where it's affecting your way of life, kind of. Your ability to work, your ability to love. People who have overwhelming anxiety, it's kind of stress and worry. It's a physical and emotional response. People who are stressed, this is a stressful situation, high stressful situation for so many reasons. And so it is going to be, it's not a surprise that we're all going to feel a high amount of stress. And I guess the advice I would give in this time is that we can persevere. You can persevere. These are difficult times. We all know it. And there is no way to kind of sugarcoat that. There's no way to explain that away. There are going to be stressful times for yourself, for your kids who can't go outside. They don't. Most kids don't understand why they can't play with the neighbor next door. You know, they're good. They may try to understand, but it will be difficult. And that in itself is stressful, right? You're looking at your kids. They can't go outside. They can't do the things they want to do. They're upset. You're upset. You have all these issues, maybe with work. And there is a ton of issues, and it's hard to really say just be positive, right? We need to carry two notions in mind. We need to carry the emotion and the in our gut, the confidence of perseverance instilled within us. We are Americans. We've gone through difficult things before. Although this one is different, as Americans before, when we're in the face of tragedy or crises, we believe in the notion of living our lives, going out, going on vacation, spending time with friends. Nothing would stop us, whether that was Hurricane Sandy in the face of Mother Nature or in the face of terrorism after 9/11. But this is a different time. And so what we use as a notion to cope with crises is going to be reverse. And so we have to distance ourselves. But as much difficulty as that may cause, it is going to be okay if we can tell ourselves to persevere. And tell ourselves is going to be another form of bravery. Secondly, the second notion we need to instill in us is the idea of reaching out to our neighbors, our friends, family, and helping support our community. Doing that will enhance or will reduce any sort of psychological issues. Will most likely help those who may be suffering financially or have other concerns, medical, emotional, or economically. We have to pull in together here. And so to keep the notion of community and reaching out, along with the notion of perseverance and bravery, will get us through this. These are two notions we have to keep in mind if we are going to get through this. We don't know how long this is going to last, and as I stated before, we can predict the future. But we have today. And today, at this moment, we can reach out to a friend, we can engage with our family members, we can look at ways to support our community, and that's where we really need to go. And that in ourselves will make us feel, I think, more positive in the face of this pandemic.
Okay. We've talked a lot about the importance of... we've talked a lot about the importance of coping skills, too. And what individual skills, coping skills that individuals can utilize during this difficult time. So I don't know, maybe you can address that, Sabrina.
Sure. So I think it's very important that people not forget about the everyday coping skills that they use, just because of the crisis that we're facing currently. So whether that's exercising. So you may not be able to go to the gym, right? But you can still go for a run outside. You can still work out in your home. If that's practicing yoga, I know a lot of classes are available again using an online platform or on your own, but maintaining those coping skills that you would use on a regular basis to manage stress and anxiety. So also if you see a therapist, I know a lot of therapists and treatment programs are using something called telehealth, which allows you to still access those services. If journaling is a coping skill that you utilize, that you could still do that at home in your own. So not to forget the coping skills that we were implementing prior to this to manage stress and anxiety. We can still do many of them still currently.
Okay. And I think it's important too for us to check on our neighbors and make sure everybody's good. I was driving down our block in Cranford, and some of the people who haven't seen in a long time were out with their kids and were just sitting around. And it's certainly you can just make sure that you are not socially distancing yourself from somebody. At the same time, keeping track of them, making sure they're okay. Mm-hmm. So I would recommend that as something that all of us can do. Mm-hmm. And I think maybe this will help us to be a little more empathetic and a little less selfish about the things we do in life, and realize that there are more important things that we should be worrying about on a day-to-day basis. We talked a little bit about exercise. One of the things that I've noticed is that when you're at home, you tend to eat more,
And when you're working, I ate all my snacks.
You eat all your snacks, okay. And so what can people do to not just those who don't go to gym gym classes? What can they do to exercise and get around beyond what their Apple Watch may be telling them to do?
So there are a lot of local gyms and fitness centers that are really proactive and work creating classes and online classes and ways to work out in the comfort of their own home. I know my gym is doing things where they're giving out equipment. A local small business is giving out equipment to their members who can work out at home. So dumbbells, certain medicine balls, and so forth. So I think reaching out to them and seeing what you can do in terms of that. We also want to make sure and research ways to work out at home. You know, we do have online access. We want to see what is out there. I do recommend 20 to 30 minutes, at least 5 days a week, of some sort of physical activity. It may be difficult if we end up like LA or California or Italy, where we can't leave our homes.
Right.
And it gets harder there, but there are ways to stay active. And I think it's vital, especially for our mental health, to make sure we do some active, some activity during this pandemic. And so look at the local gyms in the area. All it takes is a Google search or look at things online. These are ways to help increase the ability, the chances of being more active in this pandemic.
Okay. And I think it also means that just because we are self-isolating to a certain degree doesn't mean that we're totally withdrawing from society.
No.
You know, everybody's in the same boat, right? We're all in this together. And the sooner, you know, we take the appropriate safe precautions, hopefully down the road, you know, we'll be back to what we used to know as the normal,
yeah.
Right? So for individuals who have been your clients, you know, what words do you want to reassure them now or give them now as far as what you're doing here at Prevention Links?
Sure. So I just want everybody to know that we are still here for them. So we will be reaching out to all of our participants. We are making accommodations to make sure that we can still, you know, offer the support that we do on a regular basis. Again, what that looks like might be a little bit different, but we're still going to make sure that we are serving our participants the best that we can, and as we always do, and we're here for the community.
Okay.
Don't despair. We're here for you. We're not going anywhere. It may be different. We may be talking through a phone or a Zoom meeting, but we're still going to be here regardless. That's what we do. That's what we signed up for. It's what we have always we embody in our organization's mission. So pandemic or no pandemic, we'll still be around. And so if you need anything, please reach out. We're going to be there. And I also want to say at this time, you know, if there are any other mental health professionals who are seeing this, you know, I do ask that take the time to maybe reach out a little bit to your community. Offer services if you can. I know it's a tough time, but just helping a little bit. If we all give a little bit, we can reduce any of these great stress, the great stress or anxiety that many people in our communities are feeling. So
before we finish up today, I want you both to know a little bit about Sabrina and Sean, since I know you'll be reaching out to them, so at least you should know a little bit about who they are. Sabrina has been with Prevention Links in some capacity for the last 5 years, and some of her experience includes working with adolescents, students, and families at the Raymond Lesniak Experience Strength and Hope Recovery High School, New Jersey's first public recovery high school. She assisted in the implementation of the Union County Community Law Enforcement Addiction Recovery Program during its pilot phase in the summer of 2017, which has now evolved into a 24/7 peer support hotline known as Union County Helping Hand 365. She has participated in a number of initiatives with law enforcement and other community organizations, working to provide accessibility to peer-based community recovery support. Sabrina is currently enrolled in the Advanced Standing Master's in Social Work program at Rutgers University. Good luck with that.
Thank you.
And she returned to Rutgers University after graduating from Middlesex County College, where she received her associate's degree in psychology and also fulfilled her requisites to become a certified alcohol and drug counselor, CADC. Sean is a licensed social worker who possesses a master's degree in social work from Rutgers. He holds certificates as a school social worker, a certified clinical trauma professional, and in mindfulness-based interventions. Sean has a wide range of experience working in various organizational and therapeutic settings. Some of his experiences include working with foster youth transitioning from high school into college, advocating and providing supports for homeless families, and assisting at-risk children. Sean's therapeutic approach includes a variety of techniques, which includes cognitive behavioral therapy, known as CBT, motivational interviewing, and mindfulness. He treats individuals with substance abuse disorder, social phobias, anxiety disorders, and depression. Sean also speaks throughout the state about the potential psychological risks regarding smartphone and social media overuse, which we touched on a little bit today, a topic that he's been researching for the past several years. And as I said, he's currently the Assistant Director of Community Prevention, and Sabrina is the Director of Recovery Support, and they're both doing great work here at Prevention Links, and we appreciate what they're doing, not only for the individuals out there, but also for the community and throughout the state. So thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Thank you for having us.
So I thank you very much. I'm Lou Goldstein, thanking you for watching today. So I would like to just reiterate to make sure that you continue to wash your hands with soap and water and to cover your coughs. Stay home when you're sick. Do the smart things. Contact a doctor if you feel you have the symptoms of a fever and dry cough. Try not to touch your face and eyes. Don't travel if you don't have to. Especially don't travel if you have a fever and cough. And try to do the smart thing and look out for one another as we will get through this pandemic, and we will be hopefully the better for it. So stay active out there, stay healthy, and I'll see you next week on another edition of Health Watch. Have a good night.